In a world gone mad, only rationality and common sense can save it. It's Andrew and Jerry Save the World with your hosts, Andrew Langer and Jerry Rogers. And now, here's Andrew and Jerry.
Well, hey there, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Andrew and Jerry Save the World, episode 59, Andrew and Jerry Draft Kale for Senate. I'm Andrew Langer.
Kale?
Kale. We're gonna draft
lettuce?
Yes. That's
like spinach? No,
Jerry, because if I say it like that, everybody knows I'm talking about Cal Ripken. Cal Ripken.
no one that I know.
Former baseball player for the Baltimore Orioles.
I know, but I mean, Jerry, like,
you got to use the Baltimore accent.
Well, you do. All right. That's what that is.
Cal Ripken Jr. I'm going to go have some English's fried chicken, the best damn chicken.
You sound more like Ross Perot right now, actually.
Can't I finish? Hey, Jerry, can't I finish? Shabashiba, shabashi.
Yeah, so yesterday I call up Andrew Langer. Hello, I'm Jerry Rogers.
By the way, Andrew Langer. Yes.
And I said to him that there was an actual news reporter.
Right, time out for a second. Was this an actual news report, or is this Jerry saying, you know something, I'm going to tell Andrew this is an actual news report, but I'm really just making it up.
No, there was a reporter for, I want to say Gazette, but I could look it up. An actual political reporter here in Maryland who said that he was hearing from well-placed Maryland Republicans. What that is, I have no idea.
Okay. But
regardless, he was hearing from Republicans, plural, that Cal Ripken Jr. might run for the open Senate seat now that Democrat Ben Cardin is retiring. That there were, again, some rumblings about Cal Ripken Jr. So, of course, I immediately call Langer and say, look, the Republican Party in Maryland, not unlike states across the country and our own national party, the GOP nationally, is a mess.
Right.
One thing that would make it competitive, however, in Maryland, that is for Cal Ripken Jr., to throw his hat in the ring, so to speak, even not knowing his platform.
Right.
Because there are no other major players, except for, of course, the former governor, Larry Hogan. I think Hogan would indeed make that a competitive race.
So I reached out to a couple of my sources, Jerry.
You did.
I don't have many sources. And virtually no sources within Maryland Republican politics, but I do know folks who are well connected, let's just say they are Baltimore Oriole adjacent. And I asked this question. Actually, this is exactly the question Jerry wanted me to ask. So any insight into the rumor that Cal might run for the open Senate seat in Maryland. Would love to get your thoughts. So the first text I get back, and again, this is from my sources, quote, well, he was rumored to be running for governor a few years back, but seemed to know instinctively that it wasn't a good idea. Can't imagine he wants back in the spotlight. Good way to throw away an untouchable reputation. Being a legendary Hall of Famer is not a bad gig. So again, this is not a confirmation or a denial, but sort of saying this. Somebody else I asked the exact same question to wrote,
I just got confirmation.
Uh-huh.
So we can rename the show. A spokesperson for Cal Ripken Jr. Listen, Andrew.
Yes.
Tells Fox News, Cal is flattered whenever his name is brought up this way. However, he has no interest in getting into politics or running for political office. The fact that his spokesperson made a statement to Fox News, at least I think proves that there was chatter yesterday.
Oh,
and enough chatter, you know, from credible sources that his name was being tossed around.
People put up chatter all the time. Because I want to also talk about the merits of whether or not this is a good thing or a bad thing, because I think it's important. And the other person who wrote me said they would be, well, let me take off my glasses, they would be surprised if that were the case.
By the way, the report I saw yesterday was from a Capitol Hill reporter. So Axios reporter. So I mean, Axios is a legit news source.
So yeah, it is a legit news source. But what happens, and you and I both know this because you and I have both been in a position to place stories and reach out to reporters. You start the rumor and you say, "Hey, I've heard this."
Right.
And then somebody else, you call somebody else and say, "Hey," like I would call Jerry and say, "Hey, Jerry, Jane Smith from WBAL is going to be calling you to ask you about this. I've heard this rumor. I'm telling you this rumor." And then she would call you and say, "Yes, I've heard this rumor too, but you've heard it from me."
Well, again, the very interesting, this is how, forgive the phrase, but how fake news starts, right? Where you have some blogger say something ridiculous like Andrew Langer punched Jerry Rogers in the face.
Right.
So I heard. And then a news reporter calls up the blogger. The blogger says, "Yes, I've heard it." And then the news report reports what the blogger says. And then all other media then says, "It's in the news that Andrew Langer hit Jerry Rogers."
So let's talk about this, though, because we can still keep the show title, seeing as I've already done the graphics for it.
But the larger point is this, I think.
Right.
Not just how rumors get started or how fake news spreads, but the sorry state of the Republican Party.
Right.
And that's a real issue. The fact that there is a Senate seat that's up in a state that, elected recently a Republican twice to statewide office.
Sure.
I understand Maryland is a blue state, but the fact of the matter is Governor Ehrlich, Governor Hogan proves that you can win here with the right GOP message.
Well,
the fact that the Republicans have no one to run is a problem.
Right circumstances, and maybe that's Maryland in very real ways is a microcosm of politics generally, and what happens when you both have an entrenched party in power that doesn't really have any competition, and a party where you have all sorts of people competing against each other to see who can be the tallest little person in the room, and where folks are constantly trying to knock out people's feet from under them. You think about it, Jerry. We've had these open Senate seats before, or we've had folks who've run as sacrificial lambs. I think about Eric Wargotz, who prior to running for United States Senate had been a county commissioner in Queen Anne's County would try to sort of run govern as a centrist in many ways, and McGonough fell the local Republican Party. You had Dan Bongino run for U.S. Senate. That was
in Maryland, right? In Maryland. Again, but here's the bottom line too for me, and why this story yesterday.
Hold on. Let me just finish my thought here though, Jerry, because you think about it, and yes, Larry Hogan stayed on message, and Bob Ehrlich had all of the right stuff to run for governor. Both of these guys, because they were competing against in a state in which Democrat registrations outnumber Republicans 2-1. And again, I don't want to take anything away from both Bob, who we know and is a friend of the show and a friend of ours, and Larry Hogan, who was reelected to the governorship. But let's keep in mind that in addition to being good candidates who ran good campaigns, they also had the benefit of having a Democratic Party that couldn't get its act together and was nominating boobs as candidates. Whether or not it's Kathleen Kennedy Townsend, in 2002 against Ehrlich. And again, not to take anything away from Bob Ehrlich's victory. If Bob Ehrlich had been a terrible candidate, Bob Ehrlich could not have beaten Kathleen Kennedy Townsend. In the same way that Larry Hogan had the benefit of Anthony Brown and Ben Jealous that he ran against?
Ben Jealous,
I
get your point, but I still think the larger point to get it out of the muck and mire of Maryland, because quite frankly,
That's why I'm saying it's a microcosm, Jerry. I agree with you. It's all about building benches on both sides. Go ahead.
And yes. Because Maryland Democrats have nominated boobs, your word, so to speak,
Yeah.
Martin O'Malley was a boob.
Yes.
Martin O'Malley was a fool. And he won statewide office. He became the governor, two-term governor. But my point is this. The Democrats, whether they nominate Joe Biden, right? Joe Biden and Kamala Harris. Kamala Harris, my goodness, talk about someone who is out to lunch intellectually, or Joe Biden, who has the mental acuity of a turnip. They nominated bad candidates and win anyway. But here's why. Because the Democrats have the courage of their convictions, whereas the Republicans do not. Whereas the conservative movement doesn't. I'm not even sure what the conservative movement is any longer.
Well, I agree with that.
Yeah.
Let me just sort of talk about this, because, again, getting down to it, what you and I have talked about before is the issue of party machine discipline. And the Democrats have that in spades. So you're right. Martin O'Malley. I was going to say Martin O'Malley is a moron. Martin O'Malley is a moron. But Martin O'Malley is a consummate machine politician, right? He had that machine that he built and created, but that Anthony Brown didn't quite have, and Ben Jealous certainly didn't have. But Wes Moore, the entire political machine, got behind him, and so he was able to prevail against a candidate who did not have the party machinery behind him. Because you and I both said this, Larry Hogan effectively destroyed any Republican political machine in Maryland. Or more to the point, the spats between Larry Hogan and the Hoganites in Maryland, and Donald Trump supporting Republicans in Maryland, Larry Hogan needlessly picking fights with Trump and Trump supporters is what broke the political machine in Maryland. At least that's what I think.
And again,
as a microcosm of what's happening nationally, go ahead, Jerry.
And again, you and I, part of the reason why this Cal Ripken story was of interest to me was not so much that it was true or not,
but Jerry, rather, did you call this Axios reporter from Capitol Hill?
I didn't.
Are you the one who planned this story?
Yeah, I did. I planned the story to add Axios.
It would be a great thing if
I wish I did.
If it was you. In fact,
Andrew says this because I've been spreading
the rumor that Jerry Rogers planted. Jerry Rogers has that.
Yeah, well-known Maryland Republican, Jerry Rogers. But here's why the whole story was of interest to me.
And this is important.
And that is because if you look at the poll numbers, national numbers, and we get into this too, I don't understand why we're looking at national poll numbers, Trump versus Biden or Biden versus DeSantis. What matters are state numbers, state polling data. But regardless, why this was of interest is because I believe that if the tickets are Trump and whomever runs with him versus Biden and Harris, I think Larry Hunter, the old economist.
Wouldn't Larry Hunter be a great candidate? Go ahead.
Larry Hunter, old economist for Jack Kemp. Helped
in fact,
bring
it could be Hunter
side.
And Hunter. Larry Hunter at the top of the ticket.
Hey, Larry,
Derek Hunter below him.
Yeah, Larry Hunter was a good man. Anyway, but
as is Derek Hunter.
I think that Larry Hogan runs as a third party candidate in 2024 under the no labels.
Right, and let's hold on. Stick a pin in that for a moment, because I want to talk about that, because I want to prognosticate for a moment about what that means in a national election. I want to also talk about the Cal, generically a Cal-like person running in Maryland or elsewhere, and what that means. But let me come back to something you just said, because you just said something really interesting. Which is this issue of the national polling versus local polling.
Right.
Is there anybody who does at this early stage, is there anybody who invests in polling in the swing districts, swing counties that carried previous elections for other candidates? Because that's what's going to give you a real picture as to what the population is thinking.
Yes, the answer is yes, but it's usually secret polls, i.e. candidate polls. Internal polls. So therefore, if I'm Ron DeSantis and I'm thinking seriously about running for president, what I'm doing is I'm looking at all the all the states.
Right.
What is it? Republicans have to flip 80,000 votes.
Right.
To win in 2024. Now, that's true and not true because demographics, 4 years, things have changed. People have shifted. Again, in the last 2 years, thousands of people have left Maryland. I mean, by the time 2024, November comes around, there are going to be demographic shifts in Florida, in Texas. Look, you have states like California, Illinois, and Maryland, New York, and New Jersey all losing population, and Florida and Texas gaining.
Which is why you got this guy thinking he can beat Ted Cruz running down in Texas.
But right.
This is my point: is that you know, if I'm Ron DeSantis, if I'm Nikki Haley, and I'm getting inundated by text messages from the Nikki Haley campaign. I mean, we're talking, you know, several times a day.
Good for her. Guess how many text messages I received from the Republican front runner in the Maryland primary leading up to Election Day?
None. Zero. Nada.
I mean, yes. So the fact that Nikki Haley's doing work, good for her.
Yes, of course. But my point is this: if I'm Nikki Haley, I would be commissioning these kinds of polls in the, you know, to spend the money in the 25 most important counties in the United States in the 2020 election, at least to get a sense as to what people are thinking and what's important to them and what's motivating them to go to the polls. But Jerry, let's talk about this because, you know, you and I, as I was driving home from DC yesterday, we're talking about Cal and going back to, remember, Jerry and I tried starting, crap, Jerry, was this, is it possible this was 2012 going all the way? When did Derek Jeter retire from baseball?
Oh, not after 2012.
Okay.
So this must have been 2016.
2014, 2016, Jerry and I started a Derek Jeter for Senate in New York campaign. draft Derek Jeter. And I think the page is still on Facebook, by the way. You can go look for draft Derek Jeter. We obviously thought that could energize in many ways the New York State, you know, GOP, and I still think it could. Obviously, Derek Jeter has no interest in this. We've talked about this with regards to Cal Ripken, but are there lessons that we can learn from Herschel Walker's run in Georgia, failed run in Georgia, or does it not apply because Cal Ripken is such a mythic figure in Maryland that he really could be a game changer?
I think Ripken, because of his reputation as a good guy, honest actor,
right,
is a game changer. The problem with Herschel Walker was the multiple marriages, the out of wedlock births, his accusations of domestic abuse. It's very hard to win as a Republican when you are accused of domestic abuse.
Right, because his opponent was accused of these things, but it's just par for the course. I guess I get into this, right? Because
Herschel Walker was a good candidate on paper in Donald Trump's pocket.
All right. But this is, I guess, you know, what I get back to. And I think it's a corollary to what you talk about with regards to creating heroes out of people and why we shouldn't create heroes out of people. Because I remember going back to 2008, no, earlier, 2006, when who was it in Illinois who stepped away from the Senate and there was that mad scramble for the Senate seat there? And there were folks, it was where Jeri Ryan's husband, you know, 7 of 9 from Star Trek Voyager.
Her
husband was running and then he had to step down. I think that was it. And there was some question as to whether or not Mike Ditka should run for Senate.
Sure. Now just back up for a second. The reason why the Republicans had a strong candidate that year, and it was alleged,
Michael Ryan,
it was alleged that he went to a sex club with his actress wife and that somehow coerced her to go. This was in private legal documents, divorce proceedings. Guess who leaked that to the media?
I don't know.
Well, he was president of the United States for 8 years.
Oh, Barack Obama.
Barack Obama. Okay. So again, but just I say that because Barack Obama has this reputation of being the good guy. Oh. How he entered politics was literally by leaking private divorce legal proceedings. That's how he entered politics.
But this is my point, is that at the time...
Or national politics.
At the time, you know, a lot of us were talking about Ditka running, and the question becomes, well, if Ditka had run against Barack Obama, could Ditka have beaten... And I don't mean this in an SNL-like joke, but I guess we're, you know, I guess...
The problem is, I don't know Mike Ditka's personal history. I don't know if he's divorced, if he's... I have no idea. The fact is that you can't be the pro-life party, the party of fidelity and honor and our troops... and all the rest of it, religion and the flag, and then be married and remarried four times.
But also, my other point is you can't...
A reason why there's a segment that will never vote for Donald Trump.
Right, but my point is, I think some of that's a ruse, honestly. My point is that, you know, we go down the road of wanting these gimmicks to run. And I've just said this. I'm as guilty as anybody else, whether or not it's Mike Ditka wanting Ditka to run in Illinois.
I hear
or
you,
Derek Jeter.
It always depends. It depends on the context, right? So in a state like Ohio or a state like Texas or a true swing state like Virginia or North Carolina, these Cal Ripken or Herschel Walker, Mike Ditka characters don't float. Right. And that's because there's competition between the parties. These issues do come to the forefront in states like New York, New Jersey, Maryland, California, because of Illinois now, because of one-party rule.
Right.
It also comes up when you have someone like a Donald Trump who is so celebrity obsessed. The reason why Georgia, my goodness, we should have two Republican senators in Georgia. We don't because of Donald Trump.
Right. Yes.
Because of his meddling and because of his obsession with celebrity and his involving himself in state politics in the worst possible way.
Right.
Again, we supported Donald Trump for 4 years, but the fact is, his behavior in the 2020 post-2020 elections, his behavior in the 2022 midterms, his choices, his decisions, his dinner guests, having dinner with white supremacists, disqualifies him from office.
Right, time out for a second. So we're talking about, I just want to be really clear, because we're talking about two sort of different tracks here. I mean, Jerry is outlaying it one. On the one hand, In 2020 and 2022, Donald Trump told voters to not trust the voting process.
Right.
And when you tell voters to not trust the voting process, you can't act surprised when they stay home. It's just that simple.
Right.
It's like Obamacare. If you mandate that people buy a product and you make it, you're going to fine them if they don't buy it, and you're going to subsidize them when they do, you can't measure success by the fact that people are buying it. So there's that aspect of it, people staying home. And then the other part of this, as Jerry's talking about, is doing things to make not just Donald J. Trump, but also the people that he endorsed, the people surrounding him, to make them even the tiniest bit toxic to small amounts of the voters. Remember, as Jerry and I were just talking about, in an electorate of 140 million people, isn't that how many votes were cast in the last election? 140, 150 million votes?
Yeah.
Where 80,000 people... can separate, you know, the victory from the loser. If you just, you know, get 40,000 plus one of those votes to switch sides, you win an election.
Right.
And that's the way it is. So let me ask you this, Jerry, speaking of which, because as I said to one of the people who was asking me, who I reached out to, he said to me, well, what about Hogan running for this Senate seat? And I said, and you and I talked about this as well yesterday, I think it's stupid for Larry Hogan to run for president because he can't win. That Larry Hogan really should run for the Senate seat in Maryland. If Larry Hogan wanted to do something constructive, he would run for the Senate seat in Maryland. And you rightly point out, with good reason, that the no labels group has said that if it looks like it's going to be Trump versus Biden again, they're going to put somebody up, and most likely it'll be some combination of Larry Hogan and Joe Manchin. How does that affect the outcome? Well, what does it do?
Well, I'm going to be a contrarian here because I think the conventional wisdom is that it hurts the Republicans. It hurts Donald Trump more than it hurts Joe Biden. However, when you think about the economy, you have right now, wrong track, right direction, wrong track is right direction is 39%, according to Rasmussen, wrong track 56, a difference of 17, right. 17 points. That's phenomenal in right. terms of wrong direction. You look at inflation still at 5%. You look at gas prices, energy prices. You look at the cult of climate change and transgenderism. Here are two issues where climate change and the transgender issue, the mainstream media is all in. But when you dig down deep and look at what people think, the American people are still very uncomfortable with this.
Right.
It's not like gay marriage where there truly has been a seismic change in public attitudes. Even on abortion, this issue, most Americans still are very uncomfortable with abortion after the fetus is viable, after right. the fetus can feel pain. And so there are still these issues where a significant remnant are uncomfortable with Joe Biden, but gave Joe Biden the vote last time because he was presented as normal.
As the grunt.
Well, right. And now there's been nothing normal the last couple plus years. So sure. I think you put up a Larry Hogan and a Joe Manchin, and they are the normal candidates. I think there's a segment, 24. I think the recent polling shows that there are 24% of voters who are Trump or nobody.
Yes.
So Trump starts out with a quarter of the electorate. No one else has that. So I think Trump gets his 25%. And then I think that the remaining 75% are up in the air, and I think enough votes are taken from Joe Biden, and because of this wrong track, because of inflation, because of the abnormalcy of his presidency, his asleep at the switch, so to speak, the Biden, they lose votes to a normal Hogan and Manchin. And then all the undecideds go to Trump. And I think in a three-way race, I think Trump wins.
It's interesting you say that because it's kind of the flip side to what happened in 1992. You know, what Jerry is saying is that the conventional yeah. wisdom is that when there's a third-party candidates, well, actually, so that's the conventional wisdom. Because you think back to John Anderson running in 1980, and certainly, and maybe that's exactly where Larry Hogan is that John Ander is in that John Anderson mold, though maybe getting more votes.
Well, I mean, let me ask you a question.
Yeah.
The Never Trumpers, they have Biden or they have Hogan.
Sure.
Where do they go?
I think I would say probably 80% of them go for Hogan.
Right.
But I don't know what percentage of the electorate that is, Jerry. Never Trump Republicans.
Right. But here's the thing. There, we know that Trump owns a quarter of the electorate.
Right. And we know, but we also know that Biden owns a similar portion of that.
I don't know, though.
I think they do. I think he
there's
does.
No one, there's no one running around with a blue Joe Biden hat. There are plenty of people running around with the MAGA hat.
I think there are a lot of them that are out there. Because you look at the way that the polls go, and Democratic enthusiasm for Joe Biden remains solid. Self-identifying Democrats, it's something on the order of 75-80%.
But that's incredibly low.
It
should be in the mid to high 90s.
Okay, but still, listen. I grant you, there may be a 15% loss there. Out of those,
here's
under the total electorate, right?
And maybe we should do a show and bring in McIntyre or Tom Bevin from Real Clear Politics. But the fact of the matter is,
get him on the phone now.
When you look at enthusiasm, look, I've right. said it. I don't think Donald Trump should run for president. I don't think I'm not going to support him in the primary. But the fact of the matter is, in terms of enthusiasm, Donald Trump supporters are more gung ho over Donald Trump than Biden supporters are over Joe Biden.
That's true. But okay, so then what happens? What we're saying is that if Donald Trump is not the nominee for the Republicans, Larry Hogan doesn't get put up by, he doesn't get put up by no labels.
No,
Ron DeSantis.
I think if Trump's on the ticket,
this is what I'm asking.
No labels runs.
But if it's DeSantis Haley, Haley DeSantis versus Biden Harris,
I think no labels
doesn't. Hold on. The other point that I was trying to make is that essentially what we're saying is that maybe the general rule is that if an independent candidate mounts a credible challenge, it augurs against the incumbent.
It depends on who it is. So it depends on who it is, and I'll give you an example. So if I can't think of someone of this stature, but who on the right is kind of well respected? If Newt Gingrich decided to run as an independent candidate, yes, I think that would hurt Donald Trump.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, I get that. But my point is, no, we're talking about a political outsider running sort of in the Ross Perot, John Anderson.
I think Hogan, because of their reputation as reasonable alternative to the Trump madness, I think Hogan Manchin takes away the center right, the suburban mother, the soccer mom, will vote for Hogan Manchin before.
I'll buy that.
Biden Harris.
Interesting idea. And that's
how Trump lost. Right. He scared away all the soccer moms.
You know who we need to have on is we should have on Tom. Maybe we should do. By the way, guys, we're going to do a little production meeting here right now. Maybe we ought to do an Andrew and Jerry Save the World roundtable discussion, where we bring on the Tom Bevins of the world, and I bring in Ron Rappaport, who literally wrote the book on third-party movements in America. And we have that conversation, because Ron's got his pulse on these kinds of things. We can look, go down this road. Listen, I don't know if I've ever told this story on the air before. I've been very attracted to third-party movements in the past. I was in 1992... very interested in the Ross Perot Reform Party efforts there. And as it happened, the place where I was working, one of the presiding partners was one of Ross Perot's two national co-chairmen, and there were offices in our building. And I went down there to see about volunteering, and they wanted me to do 80 hours a week volunteer above and beyond the 40 hours a week I was working. And I walked away. Maybe I shouldn't have walked away, Jerry. I walked away from volunteering for Ross Perot in 1992?
Yeah, I actually lose a little respect for you, even that you would consider Ross Perot. He was a clown. That being said, I supported.
But Jerry, he had pie charts. He had pie charts, and
here are the two people in my mind who voted for Ross Perot.
By the way, I was also 21 at the time. So.
Right. And young, naive voters who don't want to have a party label, who are conservative but don't really want to admit they're conservative, that type of person. And those...
Jerry, did you know me when I was 21?
No. But and then those who thought that it'd just be a kick. They thought Bush was going to win anyway. And so, I can't tell you. This is anecdotal. But I remember going to the gym the next day, and people were like, holy cow, Perot won? I voted for him because I thought Bush was going to. Clinton won. But let me say this, though, about the weakness of Joe Biden.
I think I ultimately voted for George H.W. Bush, by the way. But anyway.
Well, we had a victory party for him at my house that was turned into a terrible, sad affair.
Oh, see, it's funny because I had the flip side of that in 94. So 92, I was still in college. 94, I was working in DC. I'd been invited to go to the RNC. I didn't go because, I'll name drop here. I was working with Ken Melman, who later became RNC chairman. And I didn't go to the RNC victory party in 94. I instead went to a friend's house. They were all Democrats, and they all began to get further and further and further depressed as the evening went on.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Jerry.
Let me just, again, just some data to show how weak Joe Biden is. In a three-way race, Biden, Kennedy, and Williamson, right?
Okay.
Kennedy and Williamson, both fringe candidates. He's still polling in the 60s. Joe Biden is. Against incredibly weak.
How does it break down with the other 40%?
Well, Fox News has it. 2024 Democrat presidential nomination, Biden, Kennedy, Williamson. It's 62-19 for Kennedy, 9 for Williamson. That is incredibly terrible numbers, soft numbers for Joe Biden.
So it's interesting you say that. So here's the thing. So as again the prevailing wisdom goes, if somebody within the president's party mounts a credible challenge, and I want to be really clear.
And I do not think Kennedy, I do not think Ms. Williamson are credible, but regardless.
Okay, this is my point, right? So if someone credible challenges a president, an incumbent president from within his own party, that president goes on, may very well go on to win the nomination, but goes on to lose the general election.
Yes.
I don't know if that applies this year.
I agree 100% with you if it's Donald Trump.
Right. That's the thing. You know, we talk about this issue of disruption.
Let me be 100% clear here. Donald Trump cannot win the general election. It's impossible.
Right. Unless Larry Hogan runs as a...
Well, unless there's some kind of third party... And again, even there, I have no data to back me up. It's conjecture on my part.
It's spitballing. No. But it's conjecture, Jerry, that is based on sort of noodling through the numbers, which is what we do because we think out loud on this show.
We do.
Thinking out loud with Andrew and Jerry. Stay tuned.
Understand why in God's name, and I'm praying, Republican primary voters wouldn't give the nomination to someone like DeSantis. He brings Florida.
Right, but it's Jerry.
He wins Texas. He puts the Hispanic, the Latino vote into play. It is absolutely malpractice, political malpractice. And I think that there ought to be, and this is, again, my problem with the Republican Party. All of these congressmen who are endorsing Donald Trump, they're not doing so because they think Trump can win. They're doing so because they don't give a shit about their country. And what I mean by that is that endorsing Donald Trump means fundraising. It means that you'll have a war chest to go and keep your congressional district. I want to see stateswomen. I want to see men and women decide to say and to do what's right for their country and not what is right for them and their political coffers.
Well, I mean, listen,
right,
I mean,
now,
listen,
the GOP is filled with grifters.
Well, right. But this gets down. I mean, look, Jerry, I think this is unfortunately where our politics is generally, because I think you get the same thing on the Democratic side with Democrats refusing to step up and say,
no, I don't think something so. I don't think so.
Very wrong. You
are right.
Yes.
I'm sorry. You're in what you're saying. There's no Democrat saying there's something wrong with Joe Biden's acuity, mental acuity, but it doesn't matter because Joe Biden's not running the show. If it was, give me someone else. If it was Wes Moore, I don't think Wes Moore would be. You think Wes Moore, as the governor of Maryland and his issue set and what he's doing, he's not running himself. He's a puppet, the progressive movement is run by the LGBTQ plus agenda, by the climate change agenda.
Right. So this is what is what I'm saying is that it's the flip side. Only one has to do with personality, while the other has to do with some issues driven identity based politics.
Right. But the Democrats.
So to me, there's no difference in the grift, the grift of folks who are Trump surrogates versus the grift of folks who are LGBTQIA.
But I don't think the LGBTQ is involved in grift. I don't think they're doing it for money. I think they're doing it for power.
Well, okay. But ultimately, so again, still two sides of the same coin. I mean, literally one side of the coin is money and the other side is power.
Well, I don't agree. I think that the Republicans are very happy.
Listen, okay, time out for a second. So yes. So let's drill it back to
the LGBTQ plus community want to change our culture. They want to change our politics.
They want power.
They want
right.
to transform America.
But on the let me go down this other road, right? Which is, you know, so
which is
so
why they're
New
winning.
York State, hold on, New York State. The governor just signed a bill outlawing fossil fuels and natural gas infrastructure in new construction.
Right
now. Right. There is a power aspect to this because they want people to live in a certain area and they want them to fuel their houses in a certain way. They want to be able to control temperatures. They want to be able to control a whole bunch of things. But there's also a money aspect to this because well-heeled Democratic donors know and Democratic candidates know that they can extract huge sums of cash out of the public treasury to go down this road. So it's power, but it's also a money component. Tom Steyer, who's one of the biggest Democratic donors in the last few cycles, Tom Steyer, yes, he wants power ultimately, but Tom Steyer knows that if he goes down the green energy boondoggle, right, that he gets hundreds of millions of dollars in his pocket as a result of it to his business.
Yeah, what you're saying is true.
Yes.
But what I'm saying is also true.
Well, what I'm saying is, what Jerry's saying is more true. I get this. I'm saying it's two sides of the same coin. You're
Steyer,
right.
But Steyer's not a intellectual leader. He's not a politician or elected. He tried.
Tom Steyer ran for office in California.
Right. But he's a special interest. He's looking to get money on his solar business or his renewable energy business. What I'm saying is that maybe this is an argument that we need to have on the right. We have plenty of Steyers on our side.
Yes.
Those who are gaming the system and all the rest of it. We don't have outside of the pro-life movement and the school choice movement, our side doesn't have what the left has. The left has climate change, LGBTQ plus. They have the 1619. They have identity politics. Queer theory. Justice theory.
I mean,
look at what the left is doing right now. A coordinated effort. A brilliant. Coordinated effort to delegitimize the Supreme Court.
Right.
They're everyone from the New York Times to every single member, Democrat caucus member of the Senate, of the U.S. Senate, is tweeting, writing, lecturing, appearing on appearing in the media, talking about how the Supreme Court needs to be set aside, expanded, demolished, changed, blown up. We don't do that. On what issue?
But Jerry, hold on for a second.
Is our side all singing from the same choir book?
Well, no, listen, I think we're all singing from the same choir book on things like taxes. But time out for
really?
A second.
All right, wait, time out. Explain to me right now what is in the McCarthy debt ceiling agreement that passed Congress.
Well, it calls for a reduction in discretionary spending, a 20% reduction over time in discretionary spending, while at the same time trying to hold the debt essentially static as to where it is.
What they proposed will raise the national debt to $47 trillion.
Yes.
What the Democrats want will raise the national debt to $52 trillion. What the Republicans presented is essentially the same exact thing that the Democrats want, only less.
Well, with a 20% reduction. But Jerry, this is
a 20% reduction over time in the increase.
Yes. Yes.
My point is that we're already arguing. Look, let me use a metaphor.
Because we're getting really far afield of
Let me bring it back.
Yeah.
So in football, you will win the game if you spend your offensive and defensive on their half of the field. In politics, we only play on their side of the field. My point is that you cannot tell me specifically what's in this plan, not because you're uninformed, you're informed, but because the Republicans aren't telling us, because our constituencies, AEI, James Capretta put out today a hypercritical analysis of the GOP deficit plan, and not that it cuts too much, but rather that it's just a mess.
Sure.
It's incoherent. But my point is that everything the Democrats, the liberals, the progressives do, their entire
right.
allied base sings the same
right,
song.
Jerry, we've been down this road before. The issue has been that over, now we could talk about whether or not it's Donald Trump or whether or not it was the Obama administration.
Why isn't Donald Trump talking about the debt ceiling? Because
Donald Trump can't talk about the debt ceiling.
Ron DeSantis.
Ron DeSantis and Nikki Haley are talking about the debt ceiling. They are talking about these things. The problem is that over the last 16 years, the left has spent a concerted effort to essentially destroy, fracture, and turn these organizations against one another. Whether it's the left or the politicization of law enforcement, or whether it's the media. So the media doesn't amplify, right, when folks do speak out on substantive issues, or the left is working overtime to turn organizations against one another, or they're using the cordons of power to work to bully into silence organizations so that they don't want to speak out on these issues, whether it's climate change or whether it's the Supreme Court or whether it's abortion or what have you, right? So the end result, right, when you politicize the Department of Justice such that you're raiding, you know, first of all, that we know that you're monitoring houses of worship, places of worship, or when you're raiding pro-life people's houses, or when you are sicking attorneys general against organizations raising skepticism on climate change, that is the very definition of the chilling of free speech. And this is the end result that happens. And so when you shut down an economy, now listen, some of this happens to things change over time. So we can debate the relative merits of, say, the weekly gathering of conservatives at Americans for Tax Reform, which, you know, I go spottily, but, you know, when COVID happened and that meeting stopped happening on a weekly basis and people got out of the habit of going, people stopped learning what other organizations were doing or what was happening up on Capitol Hill. You know, so it's, and then you also combine it, Jerry, with this fact that when you have organizations that are founded in rugged individualism and competition, we tend to not play very nicely with one another.
I agree.
Yeah.
And that's the problem. The problem is that if you look at, it's almost like, I know you haven't watched it, but it's almost like the West Wing, that show from the early 2000s, where, you know, they started each day, the president's staff, the West Wing staff, with the message of the day. You know, this is now you come off message and things disrupt that. But the fact of the matter is we're all going to sink to this page today and move forward. The left does that every day and does it well.
But keep in mind, right, when was the West Wing on? It started in
1999.
Okay. So they didn't know that George W. Bush was going to get elected in 2000. But the West Wing and its predecessor, the American president, were always stylized versions of how Democrats wanted Washington to run, or more specifically, how Democrats wanted Democrats to act.
And my point is that they're doing it.
Right. This is yes. So you have Democrats who grew up watching the West Wing, like, okay, we need to have a message of the day. Yeah. And you know, there are some organizations that are doing things like this.
I would argue that on the left, and again, just take the top issue from today. And this has been the top issue for a couple, 3 days. The attacks on the Supreme Court.
Right, 100%.
From Hakeem Jeffries, who's the minority leader in the House, to Chuck Schumer, the majority leader in the Senate, to the White House, to the New York Times, to a number of third-party groups and media outlets, they are all saying that the court needs to be transformed.
Right.
And on our side, I've seen two pieces. One in the New York Post and one in American Greatness.
But time out for a second, Jerry. I've seen others at Town Hall and elsewhere. But the point is that you have groups like the Judicial Confirmation Network whatever. Oh, good Lord. I want to say Eugene Levy, but it's not Eugene Levy. I can't even think of the organization's name.
The Federal Society.
The Federal Society.
Now, do you notice who got attacked today and all over the media today?
No, that I didn't see.
Leonard Leo.
Leonard Leo, who was, of course.
But again, this is how smart they are. They go after Clarence Thomas, Neil Gorsuch. They go after Roberts. Roberts, who has been an honest actor for the left. You go after the Supreme Court.
The most dishonest thing today that I saw in the last 24 hours was how Sandra Day O'Connor helped George W. Bush win in 2000.
But my point is the left is delegitimizing the court.
Yes,
no pushback from the right.
But Jerry, there is pushback from the right. It just doesn't get any kind of amplification. That's the issue, right? So you have Carrie Severino at the Judicial Crisis Network. It's like the old Zen koan. If a tree falls in a forest and no one's there to hear it, doesn't make a sound. But Carrie Severino can speak. You know, shout to the cows come home.
You're not wrong. But again, let me use another sports metaphor. So my father taught me as a kid. He taught me how to fight, and I can fight. I'm good at it. I'm very good at it. And my father taught me that you don't swing wildly. I was watching a reel from TikTok or Facebook earlier today, a bunch of reels where you see these random brawls start in sports stadiums. And when you watch these idiots fight, they're just roundhousing.
They're leaning
back, their head is down. That's the conservative movement. We are flailing. Yes, there is pushback.
But Jerry, and I understand what you want is a prize fighter has
to fight in combinations.
Right. And so
we're not doing that.
Okay. So we had this during the 8 years of the Obama administration, and I would say for the first 5 years of the Obama administration, we had coordination on the part of whether it was right-wing writers or right-wing activists, right-wing organizations. There was coordination. We're going to go after this aspect of it. We're going to go after attackwatch.com, you know, and we're going to shut that down. And lo and behold, they could get it shut down. But what happened is that the Obama administration took notice. They started slow walking the formation of new organizations. They started attacking the organizations that were doing this effort. They started sicking attorneys generals on them. Oh, and let's not forget, then you had the grifter class come in and essentially mudsuck whatever was remaining. And so now you're left with a disconnect between stalwarts who are doing the good, solid workhorse activist work and the folks who can turn around and magnify that activist work. So that work is not getting magnified. So, you know, yeah, you're right. It would be great if the Federal Society was out there coordinating. If Leonard Leo, and I haven't talked to Leonard Leo in probably 10 years. And so I don't know what the stance inside the Federal Society is, right? Whether or not they want to sit it out, you know, and see if it'll blow over, or whether or not they want to go and fight. Jerry's and my instinct would be to say, you know something, we're under attack. We're going to turn around and we're going to fight it. We're going to get every university chapter of the Federal Society to say something, every state chapter. And then within those state chapters, you reach out to the other state organizations and the other organizations here's what we need you to do today. But there is no work that is being done that is like that. That's what we're getting into here. And all I'm saying is that the left has made a concerted effort over the last decade.
You know, which is interesting, right? Actually, Andrew brings up a very important point, and that is the left has made the weaponization of government, the IRS, the Department of Justice, the FBI, the Department of State. I mean, you name it, they've weaponized it. But regardless, and they've done so to go after their political enemies. We've seen this with the IRS scandal. You said slow walking the establishment of new C3s and C4s, the intimidation of conservatives by the IRS. You saw it with Bridgegate, with the Obama administration. We've seen it more recently with pro-lifers in the Department of Justice. This is true. But this is part of our problem. When we have some power, and we decide to fight fire with fire, we fall apart.
And well, and this gets into the whole Disney situation.
And I give you an example. Yeah. So Ron DeSantis,
right,
and his governmental pushback of Disney have some on the right apoplectic, right, from our friend Hannah Fox to the David Hannah French Cox. To Hannah Cox, I'm sorry, and others. But here's what everyone misses. There are so many on the right who are still trying to be acceptable. They have the John McCain disease. They want to be considered good guys by the New Yorker, by the Washington Post. And so when DeSantis does this, they go off half principled, because yes, it is wrong for the government, even when it's run by Republicans, to stifle free speech and free expression. But that's not what Ron DeSantis is doing. What Ron DeSantis is doing is taking away corporatist crony deals,
right,
that Disney has received through the years from the government. No industry has a right to cronyism.
Right. But this gets into the other part of this, which is, you know, some of this could have been forgiven over time, but when Donald Trump got elected in 2016 and took office in 2017, that immediate, we just went through, we're talking about this issue of the never Trump Republicans, that turned a lot of organizations and people against one another, whether or not they were not Trumpy enough.
You're right. There's too much on our side. Again, the John McCain disease, that too many of leading voices on the right want to be accepted
voices,
right. Want to be accepted by the New York Times. And we know who they are.
But it's also, it gets into all of the other issues having to do with you know, wanting to have the hottest of the hot takes and scoring political hit points on people.
Right.
I mean, I'll give you a really good example, because we talked about this. So again, I'm on a number of different listservs on email, and you know, Donald Trump effectively eviscerated one of them, because you get folks who are just constantly sniping at one another over whether or not, you know, whether or not something is, you know, why, you know, Donald Trump does something, does it have any merit? Even when Donald Trump would do something right, he was doing it wrong or for the wrong reasons or what have you. And that's a problem in the end. It means that when we want to come together on something, we can't come together on something. I'll never forget.
All the more reason.
Hold on for a second.
Again, why he needs to go.
The late great Cameron Gray, you know, who was part of this one particular listserv. And I'm like, you know, he pulled me aside one day. He said, I had to block it. I can't deal with the back and forth. I can't deal with the arguments between people about just stupid stuff.
Well, again, here's the difference between me and I guess the never Trump world. And that is, if Donald Trump is the nominee, I'm going to vote for him.
Right.
It's
Donald Trump versus Larry Hogan versus Joe Biden.
Right. However, I, up until that moment, you know, I want to look at Tim Scott, Nikki Haley, Kristi Noem, Ron DeSantis. The fact is that I don't understand why Republicans now, why pro-Trump Republicans are going after DeSantis, why stop it. Just
listen, I got into it. I got attacked for saying something pro-DeSantis, and I had a bunch of the Trumpers come against me, and I just backed off.
But again, it's the same thing. So on what issue, if you are a Trump supporter, if you are a MAGA Republican, on what issue do you disagree with Ron DeSantis?
Well, they can't, except that just they don't like DeSantis being bigger or better than Donald Trump. Anyway, that's not the point. I want to, on this score, Jerry, I want to, because, you know, raising the Kristi Noem issue raises an important point. And actually it's something you and I haven't talked about, which was my going to see Bono a couple of weeks ago. Because there are things that I disagree with Kristi Noem on. I think, you know, she took way too much time to sort of engage in the transgender issue.
And she backtracked too, and she shouldn't have.
Yeah.
I mean, ultimately she's right on the issue, but legislatively, government wise, she took a kind of a a light approach to it.
But yes. But again, right, the point is, if Kristi Noem became the nominee, I would be enthusiastically in support of Kristi Noem.
Yes, of course. Right?
If,
yes.
If it was Kristi Noem between versus Donald Trump, I would be voting for Kristi Noem.
Of course.
You know, that's my point here. And it gets down to something that, so I saw Bono, which was a transformative experience. I mean, I was, Jerry, I have not been moved in a rock concert in a very long time. I was moved by this concert. But one of the things Bono talked about was this issue of the One Initiative, which is this idea that if you disagree on 85 things or 199 things, but you agree on the one thing and the one thing is important, you should be able to work together on that one thing.
Sure.
Which is something I feel incredibly strongly about.
Except, you know, it'd be nice if Bono, his actions followed his deeds. I can't remember Bono ever. I mean, other than working on AIDS in Africa with the Bush administration, I can't think of Bono, again, a self-proclaimed, you know, so-called alleged Christian, who came out for abortion in Ireland, and who supports Michelle Obama and Barack Obama.
But on the other end, he said very nice things about George W. Bush. He said very nice things about other Republicans. The point is, it's at least on the one thing that was important to him, whether or not it's AIDS work or whether or not it's fighting hunger in Africa or AIDS in Africa or whatever, you know, he's finding people to work with him on those things. That's my point here. You know, as we go down this road, it's the one thing. It's like, as I've talked about, I think on the air back in 2010, my reaching out to Physicians for Social Responsibility, because both organizations opposed the individual mandate, but I could not get them to sign a joint letter to Congress on this, because we wouldn't come with them on the issue going to a single payer healthcare system.
But again, I mean, I'm glad you had. As a kid, I loved U2. I've seen U2 in concert. Yeah. I think Bono is a self-righteous twerp. He wants to eliminate poverty, but also works with hard lefties who are actually exacerbating the problem of poverty. He wants to eradicate HIV, but he attacks intellectual property rights. I mean, I don't know. God bless him, but you know.
Okay, but Jerry, this is my point. You know, the philosophy is the sound one. If there's one thing you can agree on, then work with people on that.
I've said that a million times.
Yes.
You know,
yes,
I'll work with someone on the single issue where can work together.
That's why I just told the story about the single payer healthcare system. Listen, we've got a very long time today.
So how did Bono look to you, by the way?
He looked like he was aging. I mean, you know,
you're being nice.
He looks like a little Irishman.
Listen, Bono's not listening to the podcast now. He looks like a shriveled up old Irishman.
It was such a great concert. It really was. It's to promote his. So let me explain real quick. It was not U2. It was Bono doing. It can't be called a one man show because. It was Bono with a harpist and a cellist and someone who was both doing DJing and percussion. But he was telling stories in support of his book, Songs of Surrender. There's an album. I think the songs in concert are better, frankly, than the reworked songs on the album, but that's just me. But it was great. We apparently missed out because apparently if we got inside early. And apparently if we'd stayed outside until almost before the concert, we would have been able to see Bono arriving at the Beacon Theater, which would have been fun. It was a good trip. It was, my wife's, Christmas present.
And I was a big fan of U2. My problem is I just don't like celebrity. We've been burned too many times. And
well, this is what we're saying, right? I'm saying this. I get this. I've repeated this. Again, this is the theme of the show.
And also, we draft count.
And to be honest,
yeah, I know. And again, I'm a one nat nanny on this, but I don't trust people who want to alleviate poverty and help the poor and but then go and campaign to kill innocent children in the womb.
Well, listen, you know,
there's an intellectual moral disconnect there.
Okay, but again, it comes down to what Penn Jillette said also, which is, it is not charity to demand. You are not being a charitable person if you're demanding person X give to group Y. You're charitable if you give to group Y.
Yeah, of course.
We have to, but again, right, I say this, and there are things that I would not agree with Penn Jillette on. The whole theme of the show today.
Yes.
From soup to nuts has been.
I want to say something controversial when you're done.
All right. This from soup to nuts has been, we can't put our faith in gimmicks. We can't put our faith in celebrity to get the political end results that we want. Sorry, you're gonna say something controversial.
So again,
because Jerry's gonna hammer on this Bono point until I say Bono stinks. I don't know.
No, I'm not. But the I love you. But again, I have a big problem trusting anyone on any policy when they're so unreasonable and so unscientific and so unethical when it comes to the abortion issue. Allowing for abortion from conception to birth is horrific and barbaric and grotesque. It is Nazism. It is Maoism.
I agree with you. I don't know what Bono's specific position on abortion is, whether
campaigned to Ireland was one of the last civilized nations in the world that had severe restrictions. Its constitution was pro-life, and Bono helped put that issue over the edge. Pardon the pun. But to legalize abortion in Ireland.
But Jerry, I don't know if is it legalizing abortion again, as you and I have talked about, is it legalizing abortion up to the moment of birth? Is it legalizing abortion for the first trimester?
I get it, but again, of all the things to lend your credibility to, you know, to legalize.
I don't know how Bono personally views his faith. I don't know how he approaches, you know, again, because long before I was a person of faith, I was a pro-life libertarian because I view the fetus as a person. I don't know if he views a fetus as a person.
You're the son of a scientist,
right?
Like your view on what a person is doesn't matter. What does the science?
And let's also remember, Bono was not raised as a Catholic. He was raised as a Protestant.
Well, look, he, you know, U2's music at one point was sold in Christian bookstores.
Right.
He claims to be an
evangelical Christian. It's a whole thing. He almost left music as a result of this.
Yeah. And so he went from loving Jesus to campaigning for abortion.
Is it campaigning for abortion? Is it trying to find
I'm being D-I-C-K.
All right, Jerry, are you going to see, end on a lighter note, are you going to see Guardians of the Galaxy 3, or are you done with Marvel?
I'm not done with Marvel. Maybe it's funny, I want to like movies. I want to watch movies, and every time there's a movie and I watch it, I'm disappointed. I love Hollywood. We didn't even talk about the Hollywood writers strike and what that means.
About
that
if you want for a
minute. What if
Hollywood had a strike and nobody noticed?
Well, we're going to notice, right? SNL is already in.
Are we going to notice that? Are we going to notice? Are we as a society going to notice it if Jimmy Fallon, Jimmy Kimmel, SNL, if they go dark?
Well, let me ask you a quick question.
Because, like, I frankly, hold on for a second. Because I only tangentially know if Kimmel or Fallon says something interesting, or if they have an interesting guest on or segment. But I never know when SNL is on live because I never watch SNL live.
So here's my question to you. I was being cute with the Bono stuff. I was being difficult on purpose, so I apologize. But I'll be serious here for a second. Late night, whether it's SNL or Jimmy Kimmel or the other shows, it used to be when we were in our 20s, even our 30s, late night was a point of destination. When I was at Fordham, we would not go out to the Irish pub until after Letterman's top 10.
Yeah,
like the top 10 was we were there.
Right.
Um, And then the next morning, when I got older, the top 10 was discussed around the water cooler.
Of course.
Right? So that's changed. Late night has really suffered the last decade or so.
Right.
Question to you is, will this writer's strike, if it's extended, is this the end of late night TV?
I don't think so. I think only because the left and leftist media has a vested interest in perpetuating it, because it does become, you know, it becomes this echo chamber for them that they have.
Sure.
In the same reason that the Washington Post and the New York Times aren't really going to ever go anywhere. You know, they will maintain.
Which leads to another question for you. Again, we should do rapid fire. Yeah. What's your take on digital media collapsing? We have a BuzzFeed collapsing. We have Vice going to bankruptcy. What does that mean?
Well, right. This again gets now into the issue of the business models that are out there.
Yeah.
And whether or not these businesses can create alternative streams without going to the paywall. Right. It's that's the two models that are out here. You know, it's interesting, Jerry. I had I don't want to throw somebody under the bus, but I tried.
Bono, throw Bono under the bus.
No. I tried launching a podcast years ago with somebody else. I mean, not you, not John Pop, not anybody, not Mark Nugent.
Not Mark Nugent.
No, it wasn't Mark.
Oh, okay.
And the podcast, we did a couple of episodes, and this person was astounded that we couldn't immediately monetize the podcast. And I said this, but I said, no, you need to build up. You need to go, you know, you need to do it for a while, build up a listenership. No, I needed to produce income now. I'm like, this is not how it's done. The point is, it's like, Jerry, it's like streaming services online.
Although I would like to monetize our podcast.
Well, yes. Well, you know, we're about to hit a major milestone, Jerry. We are very close to a major download milestone. But the point is that it's like, I don't know how many online subscriptions to media you have and how many you get, you know, because of the job that you're in.
Right.
But it's like streaming online. At some point in time, you know, you're paying for X, you're paying for Y, you're paying for Z, and you don't want to pay for something else. So,
right.
you know, it's so.
Well, again, this is interesting because if you look at a lot of the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Wall Street Journal, National Review, the Unheard, the Spectator World, and the list goes on, the Nation on the left, and the New Republic, most, if not all of its content is behind a paywall.
Right. Right.
And so again, I'll say this, is why I think Real Clear Politics is so important, because it's still wide open debate, wide open discourse. There is no paywall. What you see is what you get, and come
right.
on. But here's a little bit of good news with all the paywalls, which bothers me, with digital media kind of collapsing. Jimmy Finkelstein, who's a kind of a media guru, a media media leader, is launching something, Andrew, in about 2 weeks. It's going to be called The Messenger.
Yeah.
And it's going to be a legit kind of news service. Listen to this. In terms of newsroom staff, where everywhere from the Washington Post to the New York Times and everywhere are getting rid of editors, getting rid of staff, this new startup, media startup, is going to have 100 staff in its general newsroom.
Wow.
100 staff in its political, on its politics side, 80 staff for entertainment, 80 for sports, 60 for business and finance, and 30 for tech and science, 30 for health and wellness,
okay.
15 for food, 10 for style, 7 for travel. So there is still
an
avenue to do this.
Is it going to be, who is bankrolling it? Is it going to be
Jimmy Finkelstein? Jimmy Finkelstein's bankrolling it.
He's bankrolling it personally.
The company plans to raise $50 million ahead of its launch.
Okay.
So it's almost like on a think tank model.
So are they going on the nonprofit, the 501c3 model, like ProPublica has done?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting way of moving forward in terms of having these a stable of talent, an arena where ideas can be fought out. Why not go the way of private investing?
Well, private investing, but on a not-for-profit model. I mean,
I'm not sure if this is C3 or C4.
Okay.
But regardless, maybe it is for profit, and these investors will get a return.
So that's the question is then how are they going to make their revenue? So these are the questions that I have. It's interesting. I mean, listen, essentially this is what the federal what the federal newswire has done, which they're the ones who are behind podcast, but they're really an aggregator, which is interesting. Jerry, when are you on again? You on Sunday?
Oh, the Sunday show, WBAL, 7 to 10 a.m. Go to WBAL.com podcast. You can hear the podcast. Last week's show was a hoot. We called it Puppies in Politics. Spent a lot of time talking about dogs and this sort of thing. It was great fun, but then got into some serious issues as the show went forward. I think this week, we're going to have someone on from the Job Creators Network.
Oh, interesting.
I'm doing
the same thing.
Okay, who are you having on?
Alfredo Gonzalez, right?
Me too. So am I. Yeah. Yes. So am I.
Excellent.
Wow, we didn't coordinate that.
No, we did not. I've been trying to get him on my show for a while, so it's good. The guys, our good friends at CRC reached out to you.
No, I reached out to – I know Alfredo. I talked to him. I did a conference call with him last week on –
I was at their big legislative launch up on Capitol Hill a few months ago.
So long story short, the Job Creators Network was behind the push of the greatest success of the Trump administration, which is the Tax Cut and Jobs Act.
Right.
And again, I talked to Alfredo last week, and I told him, my friend Andrew Langer and I would do a podcast, and we would talk about how any other Republican administration or Congress would have folded because of all the pressure. And I said, because of the good work of the Job Creators Network, Paul Ryan could not cave, and Donald Trump refused to cave.
Excellent.
But you know this. I guess it'll come out in your podcast. It's up to expire.
Yeah.
And it's going to crush small businesses and startup firms. And so that's so pleasing to know that you're going to have him on.
Yeah, I'm going to have him. We're going to interview him next week for the Lunch Hour podcast. By the way, this week, Javed Ali, who is a professor at the University of Michigan, former director of the National Counterterrorism Center, very interesting ideas about labeling drug cartels as terrorist groups. I want folks to watch or listen to the show from 2 weeks ago, Jerry. I interviewed Bob Levy, who used to do Bob Levy's Washington, the daily column in the Washington Post, former host at both WBAL and WMAL. You want to go and check.
You know, I haven't posted in a while one of your podcasts up at Real Clear Policy. But I want the Alfredo one. And I will push that out because I think the Job Creators Network is
great organization.
I'm so critical of the right
Let me tell a quick anecdote.
Yeah,
I went to their legislative launch event, one of their legislative launches on Capitol Hill a few months ago.
Yeah.
And one of their spokespeople was a woman in the contracting industry, so general contracting. So she is a Native American. And one of the things I learned, and folks who don't know me know that I'm a huge devotee of Hernando de Soto and Daniel Pipes and the role that property rights play in, you know, creating stable and prosperous societies. What I didn't realize, and of course, if you think about it, I learned at this event from this woman was, if you are a resident of a Native American reservation, you cannot borrow against the value of whatever land you're on
because
you don't actually own that land.
Yeah, that's right.
It's fascinating. Anyway, Jerry, what do you want people to do?
Well, listen to this, the Federal News Hour podcast, but then find the truth, plant your feet, stand firm, and God bless you.
Have a great week, everybody. Have fun and stay safe.